Biblically, you don't have to celebrate Christmas. I know that's a bold claim, but let me explain. This is day 53 of my reading the Bible plan in a year, and I'm in the book of Leviticus, specifically chapters 23 through 25. And in chapters 23, God talks a lot about the festivals that he expects the people of Israel to celebrate on a yearly basis. This is Leviticus 23, verse 1 and 2. The Lord said to Moses, "Give the following instructions to the people of Israel. These are the Lord's appointed festivals, which you are to proclaim as official days for holy assembly." So in this chapter, we get the Passover festival, the celebration of the first harvest, the festival of harvest, the festival of trumpets, the Day of Atonement, and the festival of shelters. All these festivals come with how they're supposed to celebrate, why they celebrate, when they celebrate. It's very specific instructions on the festivals. However, in the New Testament, we do not receive any revelation about festivals that are like this. There's no instructions on how to celebrate or when to celebrate or why to celebrate Christmas. There's no instructions for Easter. And I think if it was a biblical command that we were supposed to celebrate festivals like the Old Testament, then New Testament authors or Jesus himself would have given us the instructions to do so. However, I celebrate Christmas and Easter every year. They're probably some of my favorite holidays. And so I don't think it's unbiblical or sinful or mean, but if you were going to make the case that it is a requirement to be a Christian, that you have to celebrate festivals, then I would challenge you on that. That's actually an argument I've never heard from anyone, but when I was talking to a Muslim, I kind of brought it up that it's interesting that Christianity celebrates a holiday like Christmas that the whole world celebrates. He lived in Egypt, and even there, they were all Muslims, yet they celebrated Christmas, not as the birth of Christ, just as a day where we put up trees and everyone gives gifts. And he thought it was interesting that the New Testament didn't give any requirements to celebrate that as a festival or as a celebration. And this is why I love Leviticus, because it gives us an idea of just this is what the Lord says. This is what the Lord says. This is what the Lord says. And it gives us an idea about how we're supposed to follow him, how we are purely supposed to follow him. So in chapter 24, we get a story, and this is what it says. Chapter 24, verse 10. "One day a man who had an Israelite mother and an Egyptian father came out of the tent and got into a fight with one of the Israelite men. During the fight, this son of an Israelite woman blasphemed the name of the Lord with a curse. So the man was brought before Moses for judgment." And they essentially bring this before the Lord, and the Lord instructs them that they have to kill the man. It sounds pretty harsh, but it should make us be wary of how we are using God's name. Are we using God's name to worship him and to respect him for what he's done? Ray Comfort puts it like this: you wouldn't use your mom's name as a cuss word, would you? So why would you use God's name as a cuss word? But in the Old Testament, it was actually punishable by death if you committed such an offense. The next thing that we get is the Sabbath year and then the year of Jubilee. The Sabbath year is essentially giving your fields a year to rest every 7 years, which, as we know in modern farming tactics, that's actually a good strategy to use. It would have prevented stuff like the Dust Bowl that happened in American history when they farmed the land where the soil had no nutrients and then huge dust storms would blow literally across the nation. Then every 7 Sabbath years, so every 49 years, we have the Year of Jubilee. And the Year of Jubilee is pretty incredible. This is what it says in Leviticus 25:8. In addition, you must count off every 7 Sabbath years, 7 sets of 7, adding up to 49 years in all. Then on the Day of Atonement, in the 50th year, blow the ram's horn loud and long throughout the land. Set this year apart as holy, a time to proclaim freedom throughout the land for all who live there. It will be a jubilee year, for when each of you may return the land that belonged to your ancestors and return to your own clan. So in the year of Jubilee, not only was it a Sabbath year and the land received rest, but slaves were set free. Your land, if you sold it to someone, was returned to you. And this is how the whole Jewish structure was centered around this year of Jubilee. But there's going to be a year where slaves will set free, where people will be released from bondage. and where God's will take place. And that's a picture of what Jesus is to come. As again, in the book of Leviticus, is another way that we're seeing Jesus portrayed in this book. So that sums up day 53 of reading the Bible in a year. Tune back in tomorrow where we finish Leviticus and start the book of Numbers.